Hi everybody, Joey here again and welcome back. So in today's video, I'm going to show you how to build a float switch automated system. Now these are most commonly used for auto top-offs. However, we're going to build this for just a few dollars. Now the most basic explanation as to how one of these works is actually quite simple. A float switch automated system is simply a device that will turn on or off another piece of equipment depending on the water level within your main aquarium. They essentially rely on a float switch to control the equipment. Meaning that depending on the position of the float switch, if the water level rises or lowers, it will turn on or off the piece of equipment connected to it. For example, if the water level within your aquarium drops due to evaporation, the float switch will signal a pump to turn on and refill the aquarium back to the point you have it set to. First and foremost though, I want to address a common mistake. A lot of people think that they can simply cut into your pump's wire and then wire the float switch to it. Which technically can work, but it's really dangerous. I want you to understand that under no circumstances do I recommend you doing that. A float switch by itself is simply not going to be able to handle the current the pump putting to it. Plus, obviously, you ruin the pump and or whatever equipment you decide to hook it to when you cut the wire. In this project, I'm going to show you how to build a float switch automated system safely, which will not require you to cut the pump or whatever equipment you decide to hook this up to. For supplies, you're obviously going to need a float switch. You can actually find these on eBay for around $1 with free shipping. A relay is also needed. A 12-volt DC relay is all you're going to need, and they'll cost you about $5 on eBay. You'll also need a matching relay socket. These are generally around $3. To power the relay, you'll also need a 12-volt wall transformer. This is just a basic AC adapter. Chances are you already have one. Perhaps you have an unused charger around the house or simply a power source that you're no longer using. Just cut off the end that goes into your piece of equipment and the rest is good. If you don't have one, you can simply find one on eBay as well for around $2. You'll also need an extension cord, but you only need a cheap one. Now this is what saves you from having to cut your equipment's wire. I grabbed one from the dollar store for $1. You'll also need some crimp caps to cap off the exposed wires and or some electrical tape. In total, I invested $12. Now, costs will actually vary slightly based on where you are and where you order from, but $12 seems to be about the average price. So before we move forward with putting everything together, I want to explain what a few of these things actually are. For starters, what is a float switch? Well, a float switch is actually a small device that senses water levels. In the middle is a buoyant little cylinder. They're used to basically complete a circuit depending on which position the cylinder is in. For example, if it rises, it can complete the circuit, and if it lowers, it breaks that circuit. Now what this means is that if we somehow connect this to a pump, for example, that pump will turn on or off depending on the position the cylinder is in. An interesting thing about these cylinders though is that you can actually turn the cylinders around and reverse what they do. So for example, as is, if the cylinder drops, it's going to turn something off. However, if I take the cylinder off, turn it around, next time it drops, it will actually turn something on. For example, to get any of that to happen, we would have to splice into the main pump wire and connect this to the live wire, meaning that we'd cut the live wire in half and this would complete the connection. But the problem with that is that these float switches can't handle the current that the pumps are going to put through them. So we need to run the float switch through something that can handle all of that extra power. And that is why we use a relay. Relays are switches that open and close circuits electromagnetically. A relay can actually prevent damage to your equipment by detecting electrical problems, including overcurrent, undercurrent, overloads, and reverse currents. So basically, a relay ensures that the float switch simply doesn't fail. While a float switch actually doesn't need power to work, a relay does. So that's why we need this 12-volt transformer to power the relay. Now just using a float switch with a relay is enough to turn on and off most equipment based on water levels in your aquarium. So if the float switch signals to the relay to turn on or off, the relay will open or close a connection and be powered by the transformer to be able to do so. The connection that it opens or closes is the connection for other equipment that is plugged into the relay. That connection will power or shut off equipment. Now that we have a basic idea on how these things work, we'll move on to the build and then come back and find out how it all works together. Start off by plugging your relay into the socket. Then prepare the extension cord. We need to find the live wire here. In an extension cord like the one I'm using, there's going to be two sides. one of the sides will be ribbed, the other side will be smooth. Now the smooth side is the live wire. This is the one that carries the power. Once you get to the live wire, cut it in half and expose the inside wire. Next, connect the extension cord to the relay socket. Connect one wire to one side and the other wire to the exact opposite side, on the bottom of the socket. As you can see, one wire is connected to the bottom left, while the opposite wire is connected on the opposite side. Wire together the AC adapter to the float switch, one wire of each to each other. In which order you do it doesn't actually matter. Simply twist the wires together and cap the connection off. Connect the two remaining wires from the float switch and the adapter to the socket. These get installed on the top of the socket this time. Which side and order will not matter. Now you're pretty much done. However, you're going to want to test it first. Plug the extension cord into your power source. Plug the AC adapter in as well. Now move the plastic cylinder on the float switch up and down. If everything is done correctly, you'll hear a clicking noise coming from the relay. That noise is the relay opening and closing, which means it's turning on and off the power. If you don't hear that clicking, you probably wired it incorrectly, so check your wiring. If you still don't hear the clicking, then you cut into the wrong wire on the extension cord. Go and get another cheap extension cord and cut the opposite wire this time. Your float switch automated system is now complete. The only thing left here is how you're going to mount the float switch to your aquarium, sump, or container. And given that there's so many uses and places that you can mount this, the options are pretty much endless. Some popular mounts are made from strips of acrylic or even PVC pipe though, so research a little further and find the ones that works best for your application. To make this a little bit safer, I decided I'd place it inside of a container, which will protect the exposed components. Now the way this works is simple. When we plug the extension cord and AC adapter in, the relay is powered and ready to be activated by the float switch. Power is cut off by the extension cord until the float switch activates the relay. Every time the float switch rises or falls, it will tell the relay to allow power to the extension cord and whatever is plugged into that extension cord. So this means that we can plug in whatever we want into that extension cord and it will be powered on or off by that float switch. Now that was a very basic layout though, and you can add in multiple float switches if you like. A lot of people like to add in more than one float switches to act like a safety net. Now most people will simply call this an auto top off. However, I don't think that's the only use for it. These can be used to perform multiple tasks. Obviously the most popular is an auto top off. Personally, I like to flip the cylinder on the float switch around so that it shuts things off when the water level drops. Like when you're doing a big water change and you forgot to unplug everything. This is a great safety net because it will do it for you. Anyways guys, I hope that you enjoyed today's video. I also wanted to thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next Sunday for a new do-it-yourself project.